那期可以了。
OK OK，
那就说。好，那你看看呗。好，那那个就是听的时候我自己听就好，没关系。谢谢。
好，再下一个。
Did you make a test?
Yes. Hello world. This is a Lumix G camera.
Sorry?
This is a Lumix camera.
Yes.
And Panasonic.
Can you talk a little bit, please?
Okay. Just a second. Alright, so colorless green ideas sleep furiously. Colorless green ideas sleep furiously. Colorless green ideas sleep furiously.
Okay.
You're
ready to travel anytime
with
your
luggage
in the office.
That's exactly right.
So my first question is, can you introduce yourself?
Hello, I'm Audrey Tang. I'm currently Taiwan's digital minister.
So why did you decide to get involved in this minister? Why did you accept to join the Tsai Ing-wen administration?
For fun.
Can you say
Yeah. I joined the cabinet because the premier at the time, Lin Quan, asked me to find a cultural translator between the innovation, social innovation culture, between the Silicon Valley and between the people in Asia, and find someone who can kind of reconcile those different worldviews together in a democratic way. And I asked my friends, and they all have other business to do. So I'm like, yeah, maybe I can take a try myself. And I joined not out of duty or out of mission or anything. I joined mostly for fun, to create a space that people can enjoy the process of democracy, and while enjoying the process, also make other people see that democratic values in today's internet world, it is not always just, you know, upset or, you know, protest or things like that that are important, but there's also the joy of creation and of thinking and listening to each other together.
So you decided to create some new tools to improve the Taiwanese democracy. Can you explain to me what are those tools and why Tsai Ing-wen administration felt that it was the time for Taiwan to improve the democracy?
Well, I assembled these tools and put them to use, but just like any open source or free software projects, I'm usually not a creator, and in fact, the very idea of creator is questioned in the free software community, like who is the creator of any Wikipedia article. It is co-created by anyone who can fix a word or a typo. They're also creators, so I'm not like the sole creator of any tools. So the tool that I work with, there are many. For example, we have an e-petition platform that is, I think, the world's best actively used e-petition platforms. We have a visualization of our budgets and have each individual project in every individual ministry be a social object that people can collaborate on and watch the progress together. We have a AI-powered conversation space called polis that we use when there's thousands of people all with different perspectives and try to find consensus out of the dissent. And we also have employed many what we call civilized discourse construction kit, which is a way for people to work on each other's ideas more deeply, but without the capability of getting the trolls or getting other people who are more, you know, not so willing to have a civilized discussion to let them reform in this kind of collaborative space. There's many other, there's the Slido system which we use for the public service as well as people in the audience to use their phones, not to distract each other, but to attract each other's attention on the common public topics currently discussed in Slido. We use the real-time board, which is also a tool that makes the mind map of the facilitator, projecting it publicly so anyone who are even watching online can follow the current context of discussion. We also use 360 live streaming so that people who are not here in the room can also feel in the room. We use many other telepresence tools as well. We also use a lot of tools, what we call the accountability tools, such as a shared bookmark called Hack Folder that shows exactly the context and history of how and why a policy is made. And we use a platform called Sandstorm, which is a free software security tool that is within our cybersecurity infrastructure that let the public servants create new and novel applications, such as ordering lunchboxes together without worrying about cybersecurity threats from other places. And so, yeah, there's hundreds of tools. I can spend an hour just talking through each of them, but I understand this is a short interview.
Why was it important to improve the Taiwanese democracy? Taiwan is a young democracy. What was wrong inside this democracy, according to you?
No, there's nothing wrong. It is just with the social media and with the internet and a wider prevalent access to mobile devices, people already have better ways to organize among themselves rather than the existing representative democratic structure. So I wouldn't say there's anything wrong, it's just with times the new advent of technology brings more efficient and, frankly speaking, easier to access forms of organization. Now, it is not really decision making in many public policies, so there's a demos, but it's not a crazy. On the other hand, there is an old version of the representative democracy that works reasonably well, but because people feel closer to each other in the demos of the social media and of the internet, they feel more distant to the existing administration, existing vehicles of democracy. So regardless of young or old, I think all democracies in the world have to now work with these new tools and work out innovative ways to engage people again. Otherwise, they risk this game being not very interesting at all, lose the fun of it, and this is called what we call a democratic apathy or a democratic recession.
I guess that it was strange for the politicians, the Taiwanese politicians, to see you coming in this administration, because usually there is two major parties, the Kuomintang, the DPP, and now there is someone who is coming and use new tools, new tools, new way of making politics.
Well, I wouldn't say that, because before Sunflower, that will be strange, but Sunflower was not the platform of any particular party. Of course, the DPP helps a little bit, but it's not DPP's idea to begin with. So at the end of the Sunflower year, that's end of 2014, for example, Mayor Ke Wen-je or Ke Pi, he is also independent, not part of any major party. And in fact, even afterwards, the Prime Minister during the transition time in 2016, Zhang Sanchen, is also independent. And the Prime Minister of this cabinet, the first one, Lin Quan, who transitioned from Simon Zhang, is also independent. He also belongs to no parties. So we have two prime ministers transitioning, and both are independent. And so they did something that has never happened before in Taiwan's political history. Simon Zhang ordered all the ministries to upload their checkpoint documents outlining where they're going and how they're going into the public internet, and for the new cabinet to transition based on those public internet documents instead of behind closed doors. And this is very useful to me personally because I get to follow the transition. I didn't know that I would join the cabinet 5 months after the transition. But as you can see, this kind of not tied to any party really frees them to do things like this, because otherwise it would be seen as betrayal of their parties, right? So because they have no party to betray, they can transition in entirely in a public, in a transparent way. So I don't think I'm the first independent person in the cabinet. There's more independence in the cabinet than members of any party. So we have a very balanced cabinet at this point.
What is your reaction, or what is your feeling when you see that Taiwan is trying to improve its own democracy with the tools that you are using for it, and in the same times the so-called free world, the so-called democratic world, don't want to take risks to recognize Taiwan?
Well, I think there's many city-level diplomacy going on, and usually the tools that we use, they work best if it is around maybe 100,000 or 1 million people of size of a certain geography. And I think Taiwan is unique because geographically we're small, but population-wise we're a lot of people, 23 million. And so we can innovate on a lot of democratic tools that are too costly because of the geography, or we have the, we can reach the critical mass much easier than other cities. But we still share a lot of work that we do with other cities in the world who are also working on democracy, and maybe they're just past their own Occupy, like Madrid or Paris or other cities. And so I don't think they have any trouble recognizing the work we're doing, and we do work very closely, even operationally.
Yes, but for example, my country, my president, he won't go to the United Nations and say, okay, now there is two China, there is a Republic of China and the People's Republic of China. Mm-hmm. They won't do that. So they choose the People's Republic of China and not the Republic of China.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, but that's his decision. I mean, what I think about Taiwan's democracy, I think about Taiwan as a geographic platform, and people on there as a cultural ecosystem. I don't think about, quote, the Republic of China, unquote, as a necessary condition, but that's because I'm an anarchist, and an anarchist is supposed to say that, right? The idea is that if people think it takes a state to have a governance model to work, then people naturally become much more obeying the bureaucratic commands and the top-down system. But my whole life I've been working on new ways of organizing that doesn't depend on a state apparatus, letting people see that state is illusory. So it doesn't really matter to me personally which name of the state or even the lack of a state that we're operating in. As long as the governing system is transparent, it takes care of people's feelings, it includes people's voices, and even not people, but also animals and the ecosystem, ecology and future generations. That is important to me. And I think your president shares a lot of those same values as well, on sustainable development and on ecology and on an ethics-based way to face technology. And it is on those grounds, the sustainable development goals, that we have a dialogue, that we have a conversation, and we even have operational, you know, alliance with the ETA Lab and other apparatus. But I don't think it is necessary for the people to recognize first the state apparatus and then the governance system. I think the governance system and the international solidarity around this kind of new democratic tools, they take much higher priority to me personally than any state apparatus.
So you mean that the debate between the fact that we have to be friends with China, we have to be independent, we have to be careful of China, we don't care about China, this is old fashioned, this is all the way to make politics?
Well, I think, yeah, it is, of course, dangerous to confuse the territory with the map, right? And there's the real land right here in Taiwan. We have the mountains, the ecology, the sea, the diversity of marine species, and that exists, that is the physis, that is not the nomos, that is not the name, this is the actuality. But if you, of course, work on a more state or what we call multilateral fashion, then of course the idea is that all this physical existence must be represented by a state apparatus, and for the state apparatus to represent itself in a multilateral relationship, and the cyberspace or any other tools that we just talked about are just power projections of individual states. But I think internet was created as I would even say counterculture to this kind of state-based thinking on internet. People who are affected by climate change, people who are affected by you know, other global phenomena, they unite together in their own network, even the blockchain, right? they unite together in a way that transcends those boundaries, but they still feel very much like a governance system themselves. They also make decisions together, but they don't wait for their presidents or kings or whatever to make those decisions. They just make the decisions with any like-minded people around the world. So I wouldn't say this is irrelevant or obsolete. I'm just saying personally, I'm focusing most of my energy to these new forms of organizations.
20 years. Almost 20 years ago, I came for the first time here in Taiwan, and I asked to the people, what does it mean to be Taiwanese? And they couldn't answer to this question because they felt that they were Chinese, because the culture is a Chinese culture, but they thought that they were not Chinese anymore because they choose democracy. 20 years after, if I ask you what does it mean to be Taiwanese, what kind of definition will you give about the Taiwanese identity?
Well, to be Taiwanese is to be working with Taiwan, with other people in Taiwan. It's as simple as that to me. Again, Taiwan is a geographic feature, and on this geographic platform, there are now many people who identify as Indonesian, but also Taiwanese. Filipino, but also Taiwanese, Japanese, but also Taiwanese, right? We are witnessing a sea change in how we admit people. Previously, there was this state apparatus, as I said, you have to like be exclusively a state citizen and to the exclusion of other identities. But first, our foreign talent law and other immigration law is changing so that you can stay for just 3 years here and keep your original French citizenship and then still join Taiwan in a kind of dual citizenship. And there is, it was 20 years ago, it's unimaginable. But today it is the norm. We're trying to get more people who are also Taiwanese instead of exclusively Taiwanese. And if they identify, I don't know, not as a ethnic or as a you know, race, but rather as a hobby, like I'm a Taiwanese hacker, right? Why not, right? Because as I mentioned, the international cultures they used to be subcultures 20 years ago, but now if you ask people, maybe they really identify more with the kind of social cause or the kind of mission they want to see in the world. Maybe they say, I'm an environmental activist, but that role is not dependent on being a Taiwanese or not. So maybe they will say, I'm also a Taiwanese, but that's not their primary identity. So what we're trying to do is that this value systems that many people bring to Taiwan, being a very open society, we try to have a democratic governance model that brings everybody's voice together into something larger, that is, people can agree on the common values and find some solutions that works for all those very different concerns. But it is not because they're Taiwanese, it is because they're willing to participate in Taiwan's democratic governance systems. And maybe after a few years of participating, they will gradually start identifying as being Taiwanese, but as a byproduct, it is not an entry barrier. So I think it is a very soft thing that people kind of just through osmosis start to see the values of Taiwan instead of one single value system. 20 years ago, it's all about the values fighting to be the dominant value system, but now we're definitely a plurality now. Nobody can dominate the discourse. So it is through this plurality that we start to redefine the platform that is Taiwan and how those values cohere and decohere together and eventually becomes a assemblage that people can gradually identify with.
You are the only transgender minister all over the world.
Yes.